What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the channel. I'm Steven. This is Steven in Stereo, and in today's video, we have a much anticipated album to check out today. Now, it's kind of crazy that this was only announced really a month ago. Since then, we've had three amazing singles leading up to this absolutely fucking hyped up release. That's all I gotta say. So if you are not familiar with Ashton Irwin, first off, thank you so much for checking out this video. Ashton Irwin has fame from 5 Seconds of Summer. He is the drummer and one of the backing vocalists of that group. He's also a major contributor to the writing. However, there is obviously much more to him than just that group, because we currently have a solo project from Ashton Irwin. So we have checked out three of these singles leading up to the release of this. Scar, Have You Found What You're Looking For, and Skinny Skinny. All three have had very different sounding influences and themes to them. The lyrical content has been very deep. I imagine that will be the case throughout this entire album, because this is essentially a almost like a therapeutic moment for Ashton to put out all of his feelings into the world in musical form. And I think that is where you really do get some of the best content. As much as like it sucks to hear people are going through those things, for some reason sad music really does make the best music. So I'm really hyped to dive into this. I'm not gonna lie, I have been pretty stoked just, you know, getting, just seeing Ashton interacting with all of his fans on Twitter, Instagram, people, all the fan art that's been coming out, all the amazing response that these singles have been getting. So I don't have the lyrics pulled up here. That could be a fault. However, that's not really how I listen to music. I don't usually have the lyrics pulled up the first time I listen. So I try to mimic that on this channel when we do these album reactions, just taking my first initial thoughts of these things. And then obviously moving forward, we can check out more of the lyrics and stuff. I imagine we'll be able to pick up on some of it though, because he does have a really good way of delivering vocals, very easy to understand. Now, before we get into this video, I just want to plug my Patreon really quick. I actually do full album listening parties over on Patreon. So I'll put obviously a version of this on YouTube. It'll be chopped up a little bit more for copyright reasons and pacing. And we're here just to kind of listen to moments of this, and we talk about how we're feeling about the songs. But I know a lot of people actually like to just jam the entire album with me. And if that is you, with all my interruptions and things like that, make sure to check out Patreon. Every sign up there really does support this channel and allows me to continue to do things like this for you guys. So thank you so much. And with all of that promo out of the way, here we go. Studio monitor headphones on. These first three tracks, we know all three of them. We're still hyped to listen to them again. They've all had very deep meaning, and I'm pretty fucking hyped. So let's go. Let's start with Scar. My 90s influence, baby. Fuck yeah. Okay, so what I love about this entire intro, especially really knowing more of the meaning of this track, is you've got super heavy tuned guitars, right? Super banging fucking drums. But there is this little like moment of hope that you're hearing with like these chimes or whatever that's going on in the back. And it's good because, you know, the message of this song really is to like push through these moments. I want to say that this was originally about self-harm for him. However, there were different interpretations that I took from it in the last one as well. But I just love that you get that little bit of hope. Can you help me be a better man? Mother, mother, can you show me the way? Better man. Fuck yeah. I love his vocals right there. Woo! I never really noticed it the first couple times I listened to this, but there's also like sort of a psychedelic vibe, especially in this moment, this post-chorus moment. I fucking love it. Oh, I never noticed that bass riff before. How to love someone as true as you can. I am curious to find out a little bit of the behind the album moments. Like, I don't know if Ashton played all of the instrumentals. I don't know if he, you know, got some help from other from other artists. I do know that, or I'm pretty sure he played the drums on here. I would be shocked to find out that he didn't. Just hearing the style of it already kind of sounds like his style anyways. And plus, I can't imagine being a drummer, especially as successful as Ashton, trying to get another drummer. Like, that would be so hard. There's this obviously like ongoing harmony happening in the back of this whole chorus section here that just works so well, especially when you get these main vocals on top of it. Oh, fuck. That drum fill. Listen to this. Woo! Oh! There are just so many vocal moments in the back of this. Like, just, oh my god. Ashton's hitting some high-ass notes right here. This whole section right here just reminds me of, like, it's got like a psychedelic yet 90s vibe to it. So I would love to sit down with Ashton one day and just talk about the kind of music that not only inspired this album, but just like what he listens to on a daily basis. Because you just hear so many different influences just in this one track alone. So, if you didn't see my initial reaction to the single when it first dropped, I was completely blown away by not only the musical structure of the song, a lot of the influences. Again, listening to 90s alternative rock and rock hits were just like my entire childhood because I was born in the 90s. So, to hear Ashton take some of that influence and create his own style out of it, I'm amazed by. The lyrics of the song are extremely deep, and it's interesting that this is the opening track because it really starts to make you have to think about what the rest of this album is going to hold, especially when, so my understanding is this one is about self-harm. I also took it as when the world kind of like beats you down and it leaves a scar, you don't have to define the rest of your life that way. I also implored it to the possibility of it being about suicide. And so what I love about that is that while Ashton is able to write from his heart what each of these songs mean, us as fans are able to actually take away more from these songs than just face value as to how they were written. And that's kind of how music is in general. You interpret it the way it fits into your life. And so this song is super fucking deep. I highly suggest that if you have not actually checked out the lyrics of this one, you do. He does, it's very personal. He mentions his family members and things like that. So there is a lot to dive into with this track. Now, this next track I was also a huge fan of, and that's just going to be the ongoing thing in this album, I'm pretty sure. This is Have You Found What You're Looking For. This was the second track that dropped. Let's do it. God damn! Okay, if you are a fan of this sound, or if you're a fan of some of the influence that is coming out of this album, I highly suggest you check out a band called Daylight. They changed their name to Super Heaven because of legal reasons, but they put out an album called Jar, and if you love this album, you will also love them. They're not as well known, obviously, but definitely check them out. I think you'll absolutely enjoy it. Have you found what you're looking for? I just noticed in this verse, or in this chorus as well, you're getting those backup harmonies and melodies, obviously done by Ashen, and you're getting the main vocal over, and it just creates... Anytime you layer vocals like that, you guys know on this channel, I fucking love that. You get such a different experience. It's so good. God damn. And in typical Ashton fashion, you get a fucking amazing drum fill here. That bass is so heavy. Oh! Love this guitar slide. Okay, so I'm pretty sure, I don't know if I picked up on it the first time I listened to this track, but I'm pretty sure that this, it kind of feels like he's addressing alcoholism, and the only reason I say that is because he talks about liquid conscience, he talks about Everest being the bathroom at the top of the goddamn stairs, he talks about headaches. I feel like a lot of this kind of goes back to alcoholism, maybe hangovers and things like that. This section right here, there is so much going on that I just want to take it back and listen to it again. Fuck! Oh. God damn! Dude, I love the fucking distortion effects, the pedal effects anyways that are on this guitar right here. Again, super 90s. And just hearing... Ashton, we're never gonna get through this album because I'm fucking nerding out over songs I've already listened to. Okay, and then hearing Ashton go off vocally in this whole section right here. Ugh. Okay, so yeah, I still feel just based on the lyrics in this track that this song is addressing alcoholism. Ashton Irwin has been pretty transparent with his struggling with that. And again, because this is such a personal album, again, it's like a therapy session where you can really let out a lot of these things. I absolutely love the 90s alt-rock slash grunge feeling of this track. I feel like the pedal effects for the guitars definitely sound super grungy. I think that the mix of doing that while also having Ashton just kind of like go off on these vocals, both hitting high notes and just delivering a very emotional performance in this song. I love this. I loved it the first time I listened to it. I loved it the second time, the third time. And when I'm really diving into it in a cohesive project like this album, I feel like I have even more appreciation for it coming right off of Scar into this. These leading tracks, so much emotion, and then obviously the track we're getting into now, which is Skinny Skinny, which is dealing with being a male with body dysmorphia, although you can take away the male aspect and plug this into any part of your life, but Ashton talking about it from a male perspective is important because of toxic masculinity and the fact that a lot of people... write off the fact that men can feel this way. And I connected with the song a lot when I first heard it because I've struggled with body dysmorphia my entire life. I actually deal with it in therapy right now. And I think that it's important for someone of Ashton's success and fame to be talking about it the way that it is because I see so many you know, people that just absolutely love him. I see stan accounts for him. I see everything in the world. Everyone thinks he is very attractive, rightfully so. But the point is, when you have body dysmorphia or you have those sort of feelings, you don't necessarily hear all of that. Like, you can have people tell you those things, but it's what you say to yourself in the mirror. And I think that the video that goes with Skinny Skinny is super important. So if you have not checked out that video, I definitely suggest doing that after you listen to this, because there is a lot more to it. And I feel like it gives a very great visual representation of Ashton kind of breaking through this. Now that I've introed Skinny Skinny for 2.5 minutes, I really don't think we're ever gonna get through this album, because I just like these songs. This is Skinny Skinny.
Hey, skinny, skinny, don't you think about the future? Hey, skinny, skinny, too bad, too bad.
I also love that he has doubled or possibly even tripled his vocals in the Hey Skinny Skinny moments. It definitely gives off vibes of the Beatles. I mentioned that before. While at the same time, just giving us a little bit more, like, oomph in these choruses or in these, you know, hooks.
My damn reflection, we always meet when I'm defeated.
My second face, my damn reflection, we always meet when we're defeated. And it is so intense when you think about that. There is one person that is always with you, and that is yourself, and that is that person that you have to see when you are in the mirror. And imagine if you are already, you know, like someone like myself, I struggle with depression. If I'm already having a low day and then I have to see myself in the mirror, the amount of things that I'm going to say to myself that are completely terrible, you don't want to bring yourself down. I think he nailed it on the head with that.
You'll never make it like that.
Oh. So as much as I've loved every vocal moment on this album so far, I think that it's little moments like this where Ashton really shines.
Stop you thinking about tomorrow. You'll never make it like that. I wanna eat. I wanna sit down. I wanna dance, but hey, skinny, skinny, don't you think about the future? Hey, skinny, skinny, too bad, too bad.
Oh, I love that so much.
Hey, skinny, skinny, stop you thinking about tomorrow. You'll never make it like that. Too bad, too bad, too bad, 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 too bad.
Yes. Oh, fuck. It's kind of amazing that these songs really transcend just the lyrical content alone, even though the lyrical content is so strong. I think that Ashton's delivery of these lyrics make them even stronger, give it a lot more impact, and the instrumental choices have been fucking incredible thus far.
Stop you thinking about tomorrow. You'll never make it like that.
Oh, yeah. That is what it sounds like when Ashton Irwin fucking tackles toxic masculinity by talking about the fact that men struggle with the same issues that everyone else does, and taking away the stigma that it's bad to feel this way. It's fucking natural for a lot of people to feel this way, and I love that he tackles it in this way. This is, as much as I've loved the honesty in every track, there is something about this one that I think will move the masses. The reason being is that so many people silently suffer through body dysmorphia or even just the depression and bringing yourself down. It doesn't necessarily have to be dysmorphia. It could be a number of things. But I do know that was sort of the topic that Ashton was tackling in this track alone. And it's just fucking incredible to hear someone with his platform speaking about something that so many people, including myself, have to struggle with. And it's just nice to know that it doesn't matter where you go, you're taking yourself with you. And so the only way you can change yourself is to start to adapt, or, you know, in my case, get help, or, you know, any way that you can start to confront this demon to move past it. And obviously, Ashen has done a great job moving past it, but it obviously left a moment to still make part, to make it part of this album. And I think that's important too, is that despite getting better, you might not necessarily always get over it. You just have to learn how to speak to yourself with the same respect you would speak to other people. And I think a lot of us would do a lot better in our lives if we actually just treated ourselves with kindness instead of only treating people around us. I think that if we gave ourselves that same love, care, and respect, I bet we would thrive so much harder. So I really appreciate that someone like Ashen can make a track like this that is just so fucking relatable. Okay, now those are the three songs I know. So I have talked so much about three songs I've already checked out. So I am really looking forward to these next moments. We have seven more songs. This first track is the longest track on the album. It is called Greyhound. It's not the first track, it's the fourth track. Let's go. Oh! I love the instrumentals in this album.
No, I can't remember the last time I looked so thin. I'll bite my tongue between my teeth.
Okay, I know we're building into something big. This already sounds like it's going to be my favorite song. You ever know, like, when the first couple of, like, moments, you're like, okay, there's something about this that feels different. It started with that bass riff transition into that guitar in the beginning, and hearing the delivery of these vocals right now, this is going to be the best.
Keep on trying to move forward. Oh. I never want to go back. I won't ever let no one try to beat me like that.
Woo! I gotta do it again.
Like that. I'm not bitter and broken. I'm just torn up inside.
Also, this is a totally different style than I've heard on the rest of these songs of Ashen singing in, and it's got to be honestly one of my favorite. There's just something so pure about this. Ooh. Oh my God. God, Ashen, you are making my coronavirus flare up. My heart is racing. I fucking love this instrumental so much. I think the vocal delivery on this is absolutely incredible. And what I love is that four tracks in, all of these songs have had a different style, while at the same time bringing these very interesting, unique personalities of each song. They all feel very Ashen, yet they all sound so different. This song in particular, especially with that chorus, is like gonna be my new driving anthem. I can feel it.
Again,
oh my God, this is fucking awesome.
Be tempted by solar skin. Tiny broken parts of me. I never wanna go back. I won't ever let no one try to beat me like that. I'm not bitter and broken. I'm just torn up inside.
Dude, when he says inside right there, for some reason, it just sounds so good.
I never wanna go back. I won't ever let no one try to beat me like that. I'm not bitter and broken. I'm just torn up inside. Screaming truth.
Fuck yes! I don't know what to do right now! This riff is so fucking tasty. Like, this is so good. Also, I don't know who's doing the solos in this. I don't know who his band for this was, but if that was Ashton, I didn't fucking know he could do that. I don't know if it is. I'm gonna take a little section of this back. I'm feeling pretty doomy right now. I kind of feel like we're getting some, like, Sabbath, Van Halen moments, but we're also getting this, like, new school kind of, like, I don't know. It just feels really doomy. Like, I kind of feel like if I was listening to some stoner metal right now, this is exactly a riff that I might get. Round and round with the chase of the God damn! Okay, I've got two things that I'm gonna need to do really quick. First and foremost, Greyhound is the greatest song ever. I will go ahead and tweet that. You guys can see. Tweet. Okay, that's gone. Number two, I haven't done this yet, and after hearing that track, I'm gonna go ahead and do this while I have got 5% battery. So smart about who you buy your records from. Make sure that you are giving it to. You're giving your money to people that, you know, like independent places if you can, you know, whatever. Okay. Anyways, I don't know why I don't get the option for media mail. This is a record. My order summary. Let me hide my address. I don't know. No. Stop. Okay. There you go. I don't know if you can see it. Come on. Okay. Well, anyways, I bought Super Bloom on vinyl. Doesn't matter. I wanted to do that while we were still jamming this. Okay, well, after that masterpiece, the next track is an interlude called Matter of Time. Ooh, so pretty. Okay, can I just take a second to say that I am glad that this interlude is not just an instrumental? While I appreciate those moments, especially, again, since we're talking about, you know, I've heard some riffs in here that are pretty doomy. When I listen to, like, doom records and stuff, like doom metal, I like to hear just the instrumental. But in this, I'm glad that Superbloom and Ashton continue to give us parts of the story, give us more of it than it just being an instrumental, using an interlude to really interlude into the next section of the album. Do you hear all these vocals? Like, there is so much going on with the production as far as layering in these vocals, and I think that we've heard that on every track, and I think that's one of the things is, I just bought the record. I cannot wait to play the vinyl and actually get a lot of this to really come to life, you know, when the flowers bloom and the record don't scratch, as Ashton said. And the record don't scratch. This is so beautiful. Again, loving him actually using this moment to continue the storytelling. This felt positive. It almost felt, and this is on first listen, so I could be wrong, but it almost felt like time heals things. Like, so when he says, like, it's a matter of time, it really is, like, all these things and this pain that you're going to go through, time can heal it, and as long as you can push forward and keep going and don't give up, you'll actually get over it. Now, that could definitely not be what it was about, but at least that was my interpretation on the first listen, especially listening to the instrumental. The instrumental felt so hopeful and beautiful that I feel like that, combined with what I think the lyrical content of it is, really kind of like pushes you into the next one. The next track is called Sunshine, so maybe this all goes together. Let's do it.
You've been feeding me lies, now it's all that I know. I've been eating you up, how am I supposed to grow? So what now to see?
Wait, what?
See the sunshine. I'm not just a day.
I'm getting like major David Bowie here, which is like one of the greatest artists of all time, one of my personal favorites. But I'm picking up super big David Bowie vibes in this. So that was definitely one of the more like beautiful, like all together beautiful instrumentals. I was really paying attention to the lyrics on this one because I felt like the instrumental wasn't something that like was overpowering like Greyhound, where I could actually like chill back. I picked up a couple of different things. So first thing that I kind of feel like the song is about is talking about how every day that you're getting a chance to go again, to start again. And I kind of think of like with Matter of Time, like letting time heal things. I think of sunshine as like, when you get up that next day, just go out and appreciate the sunshine. Stop thinking about tomorrow. Stop thinking about, you know, your big plans, all these things going on. Just wake up every day and be thankful for that day that you're there. The thing that I started to kind of pick up on was possibly Ashton's struggle with success and dealing with personal affairs as well. And how being able to just appreciate each day that he's able to do these things and get out and appreciate the sunshine. He said something about locking his house up like Fort Knox. A couple things about meeting new people. And I don't know if this is just addressing those trials and tribulations of having success and then realizing that like it's such a weird experience for people to be so popular. And for him to be able to just appreciate that sunshine. Now, I could be, again, totally wrong. Remember, this is all of my interpretation based on the first time listen. But that is kind of what I got out of this, especially because it felt so positive in the instrumental. It felt like that introspective moment where you're just reminding yourself to appreciate each day that you have. So, obviously, I'm probably wrong. So, let me know in the comment section what you guys interpreted of that song. I also think that Ashton's vocals in this were absolutely beautiful, especially those moments when it would come in with that double and even triple layer vocals saying sunshine. I feel like there's just something really beautiful about moments like that. And I've been very happy to hear them on this album so far. The next track is called The Sweetness. Oh, fuck. Okay, do I have any Kiss fans? As you guys know, I'm pretty loud about it, but I love Kiss. This has Kiss vibes all over it.
No pain. I was a child. Flawless, no shame. Let me try and make my mark. When the sweet.
Oh my god.
When the
Wait, this is so, again, with these riffs are fucking heavy. Ashton, please sit down with me one day and let's just talk metal, because I hear the riffs in this. I know what you're going for here. So, I definitely pick up huge Kiss vibes, while at the same time, it's almost like if Kiss and David Bowie had a baby on this track. Like, it definitely feels that way. At the same time, there is a riff going into this chorus right now that is super fucking metal. Okay, there's also this like vocal effect happening in the back right now that's like Marilyn Manson meets Rob Zombie meets Satan himself, and it's so demonic. I love it. Listen. I'm living for this demonic voice in the back. Living for it. That is an experience. This track is a straight up experience. Can't wait to actually pull the lyrics up for that one and get more of the deeper meaning of it. Just based on first listen, this is fucking tight. When the darkness creeps into your basement, when the sweetness seeps into your bloodstream, I gotta know what he's referencing as far as the sweetness. On first listen, for myself, I could actually take the song to be about depression. I feel like I could plug this directly into my life and have it be about depression. I absolutely love the moments of having this fucking metal as fuck riff throughout this entire song, while at the same time getting some doomy moments and getting this demonic fucking voice all the way through. I think Ashton fucking nailed it with these different like sounds and approaches to this song. I just wanted to mosh in my bedroom. I didn't think I'd be getting a moshable song here on Super Bloom, and yet Ashton has again proven me wrong. So Ashton, I know we're friends on Twitter. We should be friends in real life. Like, I'm sure you got a lot of records. I got a lot of records. We could have a lot of fun just sharing some, like, doomy-ass riffs. Okay, next up, we have the track I'm to Blame. You gonna start with drum fills like that? What are you doing to me, dude? Oh! I feel like the only acceptable dance to this part is this right here. We're gonna get like a little salsa kind of thing going on, but we're gonna play the drums at the same time. You ready?
Oh.
I have no idea lyrically what this song was about. I heard a couple different things about, like, you don't want to die, you don't want to take that plane. I'm the one to blame. I showed you the light. I'm not quite sure if this is about a relationship that maybe went south or if I have no idea. I have no idea. This is one of those songs I'm definitely gonna have to dive into the lyrics after. I love the fact that this had a very heavy instrumental with an influence of almost like a mariachi band. There was something about this instrumental, obviously, that plays into key characteristics of the lyrical content here. This is definitely the most interesting track that I've heard when it comes to the instrumental. I was not expecting this at all, and yet I fucking loved it. There seems to be this ongoing theme with this album where even songs where I don't know the lyrical content or the verses right away, or the meanings behind these songs, I still become attached to the instrumental almost instantly. And it's so hard to not love Ashton's vocals. I hope that when the next 5 Seconds of Summer album comes out, he gets to sing even more, because what we're getting from him is so many different ranges that I didn't even know he had, that I cannot wait to see what the future holds for the rest of, like, his group stuff too. Okay, this next track we're listening to is a song called Drive. Oh.
I know that you're hurting me. I feel that you're hurting.
Okay, love the idea to use just kind of a drum and bass track here while we get a chance for Ashton to just, you guys know how I feel about this. When you get to isolate these moments of vocals, really get to appreciate the vocal talent. Much as I love hearing him scream over grunge-inspired stuff, I also like these moments to just get to really, I just keep rewinding this while I'm talking. Okay, I'm just gonna start it here. I just like to hear his vocals a lot.
I know that you're hurting. I know you still care. I know his voicemail sound like a lullaby. I feel that you're hurting. Just drive,
this is beautiful.
Just drive tonight.
Woo! Okay, nothing worse than a song like this when I'm not in a car. Like, I drove Pacific Coast Highway listening to NFR by Lana Del Rey, which I feel like that's how that album is meant to be listened to, and it brought that album to life for me. This song needs to be played while I'm driving Pacific Coast Highway. Oh my god. Ugh! I was not ready for that. Woo! How he was able to make me feel like I was sitting in a car when I'm just sitting in my YouTube office is fucking crazy to me. Like, there are so many moments in this song that when I finally get to drive PCH again and I turn this on, all of these feelings I have are gonna come to life even more. He created literally an entire world within this song. Also, can we just talk about that, like, 1.5 minute fucking full chaos pop punky vibe that happened in this track? It's fucking incredible. And I also love, again, the I love Ashton Irwin. What am I going to say here? Oh my God. I love his vocals in this. I think they are some of the most raw and emotional, especially when you're taking these like drum and bass moments where you're not getting a lot in an instrumental. You're really just getting his vocals. It really sounds like such a real song. It sounds like as if you're hanging out with your friend and they're recording a song right in front of you. Like for some reason, because they didn't do a lot of production on his vocals in this part, there's not a lot of double layer or anything. It's very real. It just felt even more real, if that makes sense. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Okay. This album's too short. 10 tracks, 44 minutes. I mean, he could fucking do that. Yeah, this isn't the only album we're getting from Ashton. I'm telling you that. I hope he sees a lot of success with these numbers and wants to do another one. Here's the thing. I see a lot of people talking online. You know what? No. We're going to get into this after this last song. Perfect Lie. Secret that sells. Everybody fakes it till they make it. This song feels so dark, and I can't really tell what he's really addressing in this. I can't tell if he's saying that he can say, like, I can leave without missing you, but the truth is he's going to miss them. I can't tell if, it's kind of hard to follow that part. However, the overall aesthetic of the song is really fucking dark. I was just about to say how I felt like this song was like a little bit heavy for it being a closing track, but that last like 30 seconds there actually made it feel like it was closing this. And kind of what I get from this song, based on first listen, again, I cannot wait to die. When my vinyl gets here, I'm gonna fucking throw it on, get the lyric sheet out, and I'm just gonna go through this because that's obviously like the way I would like to approach this album the next time I listen to it. This kind of feels like maybe a track where he's saying like he was able to cover all these things up because he is so good at telling the perfect lie. So any of these feelings that he felt of all these places that he ended up, he was always able to hide these things going on because he could tell the perfect lie. Am I wrong? Absolutely. There's no fucking way it's what the song's about. But let me know in the comment section your interpretation of this song as well as any of the other songs, because like I said before, Ashton may have written this album to get a lot of this stuff off his chest and into the world as a way to, you know, like therapy. But for people that are taking this music in, as with all music, it is up for interpretation. There is the fact of the way the song was written, and there is the way that you have interpreted the song in order for you to continue listening to it and plug more of it into your life. And with that, let's talk about Super Bloom. I'm not gonna lie, completely blown away by all 10 tracks on this, including the interlude, because this is not really what I was expecting to hear. And I think that that's very important. So I've seen a lot of talk online about Ashton making a solo album. What's happening with 5 Seconds of Summer? Nothing. There is no reason why a member of a group as big as them can't go on to produce an album on their own and put it out and it have any effect over the band itself. I take, for example, my favorite band, Bayside. Bayside has Anthony Ranieri, amazing vocalist, who has a solo career, while at the same time is still the front and I think main writer of Bayside. So this doesn't have to be a conversation of what about 5 Seconds of Summer. Instead, it should be more about can't wait for 5 Seconds of Summer. When are we getting more of Ashton Irwin's solo music? I think that there is the speculation that because an artist does a solo project, especially during quarantine where bands can't even do anything right now anyways, that suddenly Ashton Irwin is out of the band. I don't think that's the point of this. And I think this album is proof of that. He said in an interview that he had songs that were so personal he couldn't have someone else sing them. That makes total sense to me. And as somebody who grew up listening to a lot of bands, especially like some of my favorite albums are the most depressing albums, I used to think to myself, man, if the singer didn't write this song, I don't know if you could get the emotion across the same. And this song, or this album, song and track by track, sounds nothing like 5 Seconds of Summer. And I think that's important. He didn't try to go off and make a solo 5 Seconds of Summer album. That's not what he wanted to do. He likes being in that group, obviously. But when you get a chance to sit down and put out all of your own things with no input from anyone else, you just write your music the way that you want to write it, have it distributed under Ashton Irwin Music Group, LLC. Good for you, dude. You get a chance to express yourself and it doesn't have to taint the career of 5 Seconds of Summer. I think people get the complete wrong idea about this stuff. I think that Ashton Irwin deserves all the praise for this album because it is not 5 Seconds of Summer. Listening to this track by track, I already knew when Skinny Skinny dropped that we were getting something very different. But when he dropped Have You Found What You're Looking For and Scar, my opinion of what this album is going to be changed drastically. And the more and more that I'm hearing the metal influence on this album makes me want to sit down. Again, Ashton, I know we're friends on Twitter. Be my friend in real life. Let's talk metal. We can listen to Typo Negative together. We can have a great fucking time jamming just some fucking awesome albums because I'm hearing a lot of stuff in this that makes me think that you listen to a lot of the same music that I do. Now, obviously, I need to sit down and revisit this album with the lyrics, but what I got from this was something very personal and something that I cannot wait to listen to over and over again. I'm so glad I bought the record. I cannot wait to dive into this again, but I really hope you guys liked today's video. Don't forget, if you want to check out the full album listening party where we jam this whole thing together and just have a great time, make sure to support on Patreon. The link is in the description. I have a ton of listening parties. I've done the 5 Seconds of Summer movie. I've done 5 Seconds of Summer albums. I think we're gonna do some live performances as well. I've done a lot of other bands as well. So make sure to check that out. There's a nice little tag system. You can see all the people that I've covered and what I've covered from them. I really hope you guys like today's video. I'll see you in the next one. Peace.